Hello and welcome to the Server2Server course brought to you by CJR Gaming. My name is Christian Richards, and in this video we are going to start off by moving from RC7 of Photon 3.0 to the final version of Photon 3.0 and the couple of changes that it takes for that. I've already gone ahead and installed Photon to the same location as I previously had it, so my references come in fine, but as soon as I do a rebuild, you'll see that there's on disconnects that are, it says, not being implemented. If we open up any one of these and we go down, you'll see we do have an on disconnect, and it is overriding, but it doesn't have these extra arguments within the parameters there. So we'll go ahead and put those in. For this first part, we need a disconnect reason called reason, and then we need a string for the message. Now, taking a look at the disconnect reason, you'll see there are four different types: a client disconnect, managed disconnect, server disconnect, and timeout disconnect. A client disconnect is any time the client disconnects. A timeout disconnect is any time the client no longer talks to the server. So if something happens to the internet, packets get delayed, someone unplugs their internet connection, some type of thing where the client actually hasn't requested a disconnect, you'll get a timeout disconnect. The server disconnect happens anytime that something goes wrong with the server shuts down, and it's just going to kick all the users off. And then the last thing that happens is the managed disconnect, and that's anytime you as the developer has the server disconnect a user. So for those of you who like to go model things like a MMO would, the client requests a disconnect. You wouldn't actually do the client disconnect. You would actually set up some kind of timer that after, say, 15 seconds or whatever, the managed disconnect would actually get used, and it would disconnect the client. If the client were to disconnect, that would be the equivalent of them going in and saying, a forceful disconnect, as opposed to waiting out the timer. And that way you can get a feel for what they're actually trying to do, and you can keep the character logged in if you need to. Say there's an NPC beating on them, they can't just yank the plug and poof, they're offline now. You can actually figure that out and be able to deal with it. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to add the message to our debug format so that when we remove the disconnected peer, we can actually see what the message is, and we can actually go further and put in the reason first. Excuse me. And that way you can see what the reason is, as well as the message that went along with it. And now we need to do this same thing in the other two files, the incoming subserver peer. So we'll just paste that in, import the selected type, and then same thing with the master server peer. Go ahead and just paste that in. With that done, go ahead and rebuild, and you'll notice that everything succeeded. Last time we left off with the ability to look up a user, but no way to actually get the user into the system. It's not exactly true. You could hand jam a user into the database and then run through this function and make sure that it actually finds the user, as opposed to just, you know, saying that it doesn't, there's nothing there. But we are going to actually go ahead and handle the registration today. So I'm just going to add a new item. It's going to be a new class. I'm going to call it the Register Request Handler. And when it comes in, I'm just going to go ahead and get rid of all the includes. I'm going to copy the login code and just paste it in after, and then go ahead and import all the different types. Lastly, change the constructor so that it's of the register request handler type, and go ahead and save the file. Now, like before, when we're doing the lookup in the login, with the login, we actually want to find the user. With the registration, we want the exact opposite. So we can keep this code in here and use it to our advantage to say if it's not equal to null, the user already exists, and we can throw an error back to the client that says that user already exists, you'll have to pick a different name. To get the rest of the data, I'm just going to go ahead and create a var username, set that equal to this operation request, getting the parameter code for the username. I'm going to make a quick copy of it, change this one to password, and password, and then use ReSharper to create that enumeration within the parameter code. Next, I'm going to grab the username, put it in here so that we use constant variables throughout our software, or throughout this function anyway. And then next, I'm going to say if user does not equal null, meaning we found a user, what we're going to do is we're actually going to grab the send operation code, go ahead and pass back the operation code, but we're going to use the parameterized constructor in order to send back a return code of error code.username in use. And then we'll also go ahead and pass back a debug message of username is already in use. I'm going to go ahead and leave this as English. The reason I would do this on the server is so that from the server standpoint, you could actually figure out what, you know, language they're using. You could pass in that, or for in this case, it's just to facilitate ease of use, and then in the client, use internationalization. I went ahead and also put it into the error codes just using ReSharper there. And then the last thing I'm going to do is actually I'm going to come up here and I'm going to cast this to a short. And even though we cast that enumeration to a short, you hover over this and it still says that our error code must be of type short. By doing it in the enumeration, it ensures that we'll never go over the 255 max for our error codes here. And then in here, it needs it because now this is an enumeration and not a short. So we have to cast it back to a short there. The other thing you could do is you could just put in like operation invalid or operation denied. And then within the parameters that go to the operation response, you can put in an error code. And that'll give you a larger error code base to work with. I chose to do it this route simply because it's easier on us right now. We just have an enumeration that we use right here rather than adding in parameters. Next, we're going to go ahead and just close out our transaction. So in this case, nothing happens. We close out our transaction and then we're going to return. Now, if we, if our user does not equal null, we're going to go ahead and actually create that user. So I'm going to say user equals new user, and then use the parameterized constructor again here in order to create this user. The algorithm, like before when we set up the defaults, is going to be SHA1. The username is going to be equal to the username. The salt is going to be equal to the salt, which we'll create in just a second. The password is going to be what we set it to here in just a second. And then lastly, we're going to go with created equals datetime.now, and then updated equals datetime.now. So there's that. So now we need to create this salt and then actually get our password, which is a combination of the password plus the salt run through an SHA1 algorithm. So first our salt, I'm going to set this equal to GUID.newGUID, do a toString on that, and then do a replace, and I'm going to replace the hyphens with no character. So it just yanks the hyphens out, gives us a nice 32-digit hexadecimal string that we can use to salt our password with. All right, so that takes care of the salt. Here we have the username. And it wants some kind of object, so we're actually going to go ahead and cast that to a string, or we'll leave it as a var, and actually come up in here and cast that object to a string. Same thing with the operation request for the password. We're going to just go ahead and cast that because we will need it that way in a minute. For the password, we are going to need a bit converter, and we're going to need a dot toString on this, and the byte value that we're going to use is actually going to be the result of our SHA1. Now, I can never remember the SHA1 name, So I am going to do system.security.cryptography. And then from in here, I can actually just do an SHA1 crypto service provider. We call the .create, don't give it a hash name, and then we're going to do a .compute hash, and then here's where we're actually going to pass in the salt plus the password. Now, to compute this hash, it needs to have a byte array. In order to get that byte array, we're actually going to take this salt plus a password. We're going to call encoding, which is from system.txt. We're going to use UTF-8. And we're going to say get bytes, and we're actually going to pass in the salt and the password. So now this is going to create a series of bytes for the password, which is our GUID plus the user's password. It's then going to take and it's going to compute the SHA1 hash for that, and then it's going to take that byte array and convert it using the bit converter back into a string that we can store in our password field. Now the last thing we're going to do is just because of the way the algorithm works, we're going to want to do a dot replace, and we're going to do again a replace of dashes to empty quotes. This is more for how it works if we are going to work with a web server and they create their users through a web server. It needs to match that same thing, and so in order to do that, we go ahead and we do this replacement of the hyphen. So if any hyphen shows up for whatever reason, it goes ahead and removes it. Next, we have this variable conflict here. So we'll just go ahead and call this one user to create. So there's our user. The next thing we're going to need to do is we're going to need to do a session.save, pass in our user to create, do a transaction.commit so that it commits our transaction, and then we don't really need this log debug anymore, but we can go ahead and say created user, and then we'll just put in here, yeah, we'll leave it like that, user.username, actually no, because that is null, we're going to use user to create dot username. So we have our transaction, we get all the data out of our operation request, we update the user if that username is taken, and we go ahead and close out the transaction. If the username isn't taken, we go ahead and we go all the way through to here. So the next thing we really should be doing is we really should tell them, the user, that it was successful. So we'll go ahead and do another one of these. Instead of passing in a return code, we can actually just go ahead and pass in the operation request. Actually, we're going to do a new set of parameters. We're going to say new dictionary, byte object. Go ahead and import that, and then we're actually going to say we're actually going to do a key of parameter code dot, actually I like it better the other way, we're going to go ahead and just do a return code of error code dot okay. And then again, we have to cast that to a short. So that way we can do a lookup and see that our return code said okay, which means that our operation was successful. We can go ahead and take out this transaction.commit. And then the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put in this exception here, and I don't want to throw it. What I actually want to do now is do a log.dd debug format, and we are just going to say we're going to do quote 1 or 0 and then pass in E. So error registering user and pass in that error so that it'll print out that error. And then it'll go ahead and send an operation back to at least let them know that something happened, and then go ahead and exit out of there. And for those of you who like to do security type things, if there was an error, what I like to do is I like to say this. I like to put this as a last resort so that when the user gets something back, all they see is that a username is already in use, which is why we go ahead and do a debug log here. That way we know within our logs that an error occurred. For the user themselves, they don't get any information. So we're creating more of a black box. The user doesn't know that anything happened other than that username is in use. Not as useful in the register request, but it's definitely more useful in something like the login request. And so with that, we now have the registration process in place. So if we bring up the client, we pass a register command, then we'll get back a new user that we can then use our login register handler to handle. The last thing we need to do now is inside of our login server, we were using we were just using a dictionary of handlers. So we're actually going to want to add in a new one of these here. Something like this. And then change this to a register request handler, and then use a resharper to go ahead and add that enumeration. If we let that rebuild, we'll see that that succeeded. And now we can look at the client for sending both login and register commands. Till then.